So one of my distractedness in the opening round, because I was partly thinking about the session, was there's three slides from yesterday that we didn't show. I quite like to talk over, but I think if I put them in now, it's going to get us off to a funny start, really. So if we've got time later on, I'd like to come back to them. So I do think they bring some stuff that's important to talk about. But let's use this session just to talk about this aspect. And
do you have handouts for these slides?
Yeah, they're just about to come.
Yeah.
I'll talk slowly to begin with so that catch up before we really get into it. I think I did some throwaway remark yesterday, like, oh yeah, tomorrow stuff will be easier. Well, I hope it would be easier in the hearing of it, but actually, in his writing of it, it's even more complicated than the stuff that we said yesterday. And in the book Being and Time, it's got Division 1 and Division 2. And he was Heidegger submitted this to get his professorship or something like that. So he presented Division 1, which is all the stuff we did yesterday, and they said it wasn't enough. God knows what they want. Anyway, so then he rushed forward with this Division 2, which is all the stuff on the existential stuff. And it's not written very well. I mean, the first bit is impenetrable, but at least once you understand the language, it's got a logic to it. The second stuff, I think, is just been written in haste, really, and the order's all tricky. And also there's different interpretations. So what I've done is try to present a kind of a cleaned up version, if you like, which is drawn from there's a book by a guy called Blattner there, who's done a lot, and also the Dreyfus interpretation. So I've tried to pull together this in a coherent way. I think that if and when I do this again, this is the bit that I will need to really come back to and sort of dig into more. Anyway, that's just a preamble in case ever any real philosophers ever hear this. But we're going to do the existential aspect, and we talked a bit about it yesterday, and this is the key phrase, really, that, as I said, that really caught me many years ago and captures this in its very being. That being is an issue for it, in other words, for us, that our very being, who I am, is an issue. It's a concern. And it's not so much a concern that I'm thinking about all day. It's more a background angst, a background sense of... Dreyfus talks a bit about an unsettledness in the world. That we can be doing what we're always doing in our daily activity, but there's a kind of unsettledness. I guess it's that kind of question, what's it all about kind of question that I don't know if it haunts you, but it certainly haunts me. So it's not foreground all the time, but it somehow never quite goes away, and sometimes it does become more foreground. I've got a quote here, which I'll just let you read, which has come from this book, which is Irvin Yalom's book, which is a nice little number called Staring at the Sun. It's subtitled Overcoming the Dread of Death. I bet the marketing people had some trouble with that. But anyway, have a read. Just have a read of that. Can you?
He's a great writer. I've read three of his books, haven't I?
Yeah.
And I recommend.
Is it? Can you give it to me?
What was the subtitle?
Overcoming, staring at the sun, overcoming the dread of death. if you've any thoughts about that. Ontology is just a philosophical word for the nature of being, you know, so it's the nature of our being, you know. So in that sense, well, you know, who am I really, and, you know, what's it about?
It feels more spiritual, is that kind of description?
Well, I think that is one way of coming at it. There isn't much around spirituality, at least in this, but it certainly, I think, connects with that sense. If that's your background sense of being in the world, that's spirituality part of it.
I can see that, you know, the last sentence about sort of responsibility and the authentic life, and I think what we try to do in coaching is get people to be authentic.
Yes.
You can see how that
yes.
makes sense.
I think the second part of that inner change is the impact of that change has to be found in the first part.
Well, the hiding stuff is both, as we'll see, he talks about possibilities. It's a change, possibilities in us to change. It's also how that change, what would be in the possibilities of the outside world too. So it goes both ways. What are the possibilities in the world, and what are the possibilities in me that would need to be engaged to let that happen? Okay, well this sets the scene. And I've already mentioned that the what we did yesterday was all about his analysis of the basic nature of us being in the world. And as you saw, it was all about us being very much cultural beings, social beings. And read on its own, it feels like a form of you know, sort of social determinism. Really. We are just who we've been made into by our culture, but in this second part, the exchange part, you find a real tension in Heidegger, because he can see that this is part of our nature, this social being, but he also has this sense of if that's all we are, then we're kind of lost really. So he's done this very deep analysis, but it's got something missing. And so for him, the thing that's missing from it is this sense that our being is an issue for us. But in a sense, and he's taking that phenomenologically, like I said yesterday, like that is our experience. At least it is for us in the West, I think. So there is I have a concern about how this is my life, it's the only one I have, how am I going to live it? And for him, that's what starts to pull us away from just doing what they do. And he starts to use language. He came from reading Kierkegaard. Kierkegaard was a big impact on him. And he starts using language that has a kind of spiritual ring about it. He talks of falling. He talks that we can fall into just the conventional way of life. So, and he talks about living away from ourselves, as if just to go along with what people do is not enough. He talks about the self being dispersed into the conventional truths. We don't really see the possibilities in situations. We just go along with how people normally see it in everyday life. So there is something here about this existential notion. Is there's something more about how we own our own lives. And throughout Heidegger, that I think this tension is critical and crucial. On the one hand, he's saying we are cultural beings, but he says if that's all, then we are not living our own lives. We're kind of lost in the one.
Jeff, on the third paragraph, the sort of falling into things and simply going along whatever one does, I went to a briefing about 3 weeks ago by the chief executive of the authority, and he was talking about the 48 million patent cuts, and he was putting that in the sense of we now we've got to do things differently, we've got to find new ways of doing our business, etc. And that's all about sort of exploring these things where I would have thought, well, my experience of being in that organisation for 17 years now, is that you had to conform. There was one way of doing things. Now it's sort of being said no, we've got to find new ways of doing things, to be more creative. So that falling into simply going along with things has been sort of my experience of working in that organisation, really, to go along with the way things work.
Well, I think the notion of falling is interesting in terms of, I think, gravity. It's almost like this analogy here with gravity. We almost fall into the culture that there is. And it's always there, that pull to just go along with and just do it. We learn it tacitly, like we talked about yesterday. We just find ourselves doing it without... It becomes the air we breathe through, the atmosphere we're in. So the question or the call, again, we'll see, he uses this notion that somehow we are called to do something different. Now there's a lovely expression where he says, we're called, but who or what is calling? But again, there's that existential notion, do I understand what he means? And I think I do. Check it out for yourself, do you know? Or if that calling isn't there, it's like, it's as if there's something important missing.
One thing that struck me as we were looking at that, I wrote down a sort of nature nurture thing. Well, if nature is something that's innate in us, and nurture is something that's learned, it's that sort of that being and that sort of cultural environment. And just made me ask the question, has the learned behaviour of us become so embedded that it's almost become our nature?
That's
what he's actually going to have, so I'm like,
absolutely.
But I think you can see that when you're working with certain coaching clients as well.
Yeah.
That certain behaviours are so ingrained.
Yeah.
It is their default.
Yeah.
That it is their nature to be like that. And so if you're conscious that it's that strong, it feels a longer term journey almost that coaching can offer some of those people.
Yes.
That's what strikes me about that.
Yeah.
Because it's taken me a bloody long time to realise that for myself.
And the existential thing is that it's coming from a different place. It's not about nature or nurture. It's about, are we going to own our lives?
Yes.
And about the can we grasp the possibilities in our lives? So for him, the essence is potentiality to be.
Yes.
No matter what culture and how much we've been in culture, he's saying you can't step out of it. Whatever the possibilities in yourself, they can only be expressed in social roles. There isn't any other place to do it, you know. So even though this is his existentialism, if you like, is utterly embedded in the world we're in.
I thought an example this morning when we had the opening round that we've developed a practice between us, our culture,
absolutely,
that we each speak once.
Yeah.
And then there's silence until somebody else speaks. We don't talk across each other.
Yeah.
We don't speak more than once.
Absolutely.
We don't respond to each other. Now, none of that has been agreed that that's how we will conduct ourselves, but we've developed a pattern.
Yeah.
awareness of one you had already spoken, and Anne-Marie said something that was really interesting about what you've done with Maria. And I wanted to respond to that and think about, perhaps we get that look on the ask what your kind of summary. And I was aware of myself, I think, really wanting to say that, but also this kind of internal struggle, but I've already spoken. And so I want to say something about I've already spoken. I tried to kind of overcome that thing, which I've taken in, I've kind of absorbed part of the kind of the culture that we have created, even though nobody's saying that's how we have to behave with each other. So it's kind of interesting,
yeah.
that feeling of to try to get past that, to say something I don't want to say.
And
really stuck with them.
And all the groups, all the programs we do run the same way. So what you're experiencing about somebody speaks and you don't start to have a conversation about what they said, that there's a check-in, everyone takes their own turn.
Yeah.
It's exactly, and I'm sure that if you started doing that at some stage, we would put you right.
Mm.
And it might not be direct saying, don't do that. It would be something like, we're trying, okay, that's good, but let's hear from other folk. Or some way of sending the tacit message about
yeah.
it. There is, and it's a great example. So we have our own. I've wondered about. We have our own practices here, which sitting in the circle, not having a table, all that stuff is our practices. And it feels like we tried something different for the experiential group last time, remember?
Mm-hmm.
And that felt for me, because I've always done experiential groups the way we normally do. So it's like, is this all, even me, I run the damn things like, is this all right? And it's almost like Heidegger's notion of the one. It's almost like I'm asking the one, because this is the way they do it. This is the way, it's almost like, well, it's intriguing, isn't it?
Some of that came out of the polarities, isn't it? That some things are held in us back.
Yeah.
And we broke out of it by moving.
Yeah.
But it doesn't mean to say the culture's bad. Because you may make a decision to say, well, actually, my best contribution is in that culture.
Does that thing have a take on the need aspect of it in terms of an individual need to be included and accepted in the community, that kind of collective culture again, or need against the individuality? Kind of?
Well, he starts from us as a communal being, and he's got quite a lot about the us as with, but this whole thing about that we follow the norms, we do what we do, and how the subtle sanctions or subtle not so subtle sanctions are if we deviate, I guess is exploring that same territory. Like if you're in the opening round, you don't burst into song. Would you want to stay here? But you don't need it.
You could,
yeah, it's one of the possibilities.
Yeah.
If moves moved.
You might be
I think for me with that's sort of that sense of living away from myself. I understand that feeling at times when I'm doing some task I know as I do that's incredibly repetitive and dull, or that sort of, there's a sort of sense of going through the motions of my life rather than being engaged in the washing up. It's just something I don't want to be doing, but I'm making myself do it because I have to do it. So that, I think that's quite a recognisable thing. But if I think about changing that, then I become anxious. There's sort of like a real tension there in individual sense.
Seems to kind of go into Holly's point about that sort of sense of need is that if you're looking at the Heidegger thing and coaching and that sense of yesterday, that cultural norm of being with, and kind of like that need to sort of be in that norm compared with that need to fulfill potential do your own thing. When someone's coming to coaching, that one of those is going to be out of kilter. And it's about working, I think, for me as in a coaching mode, around how do you find which is the dominant, or going into Gestalt, which one becomes more liberal. Because if you're thinking it's around the change, and actually it's the norm, it's the, you know, you. finding which one is the most vital one for that person, and the one that they have to kind of honour and respect in what it is in that change that they're trying to do. So
coaching is in really, this is the territory, isn't it? It's about meeting somebody and they are as they are, this is how they do stuff. There'll often be a sense of unsettledness, if you like, unsatisfied about this. And so the coaching is about, well, what are the possibilities here? And how to step into those possibilities, which means being different and doing different things. And then the unsettledness that creates, the anxiety it creates, and also in the real world, the pushback that you're likely to get. Because this stuff, as